Hi again everyone. In this video, I will discuss two additional equilibria that you will be testing today as part of your Chatelier's principal lab, which are in parts B and C. The first of these two equilibria is called solubility equilibrium. There are two goals in this section, which is to calculate KSP and to shift the equilibrium using volume and temperature. Before we can talk about how to get goal number one, I have to explain what this equilibrium is about first, which will take some time. So let's get started. To discuss this equilibrium, let's bring back a concept you learned in Chem 11. Recall that salts are divided into soluble and insoluble based on the solubility rules. Here's a table of solubility rules, probably a bit more detailed than the one that you used to, but the information is the same. Typically, just to simplify things, even slightly soluble salts are categorized as insoluble. So for example, if I were to mix barium nitrate with sodium fluoride, in Chem 11, I will write my reaction as shown, which is a double displacement reaction, and then I would predict my products to be barium fluoride and sodium nitrate. Using the solubility rules, I can categorize the barium fluoride as insoluble. We can further write the net ionic equation, which removes all the spectator ions as barium ion plus two fluoride ions forming barium fluoride. If I were to carry out this reaction, we expect the following. We add to a clear solution of barium ion, note that the nitrate ion is not shown for clarity, another clear solution containing the fluoride ion. Again, the sodium is not shown. Once we mix these two, we see a cloudy solution, which tells us that a precipitate or a solid has formed inside the solution. In reality, things are not as black and white as it seems. The insoluble salts are not completely insoluble. In all cases, when a salt is categorized as insoluble, a small amount of that salt can dissolve in water. In fact, there's a reversible process where the salt dissolves and dissociates to form ions, and the ions recombine to form the precipitate until the process reaches equilibrium. The equation can be written as shown for an insoluble salt with the formula AXBY. Note that this equation is just the reverse of the net ionic equation for the insoluble salt. So, for the barium fluoride example, it would look just like this. Barium fluoride dissolving and dissociating into barium and fluoride ions. The equilibrium constant for this process is given as KSP, which is equal to barium concentration times fluoride concentration squared. Since the reactant is a solid, it's not part of the K expression. The SP here stands for solubility product, because the K expression is composed of the product of the solubility equilibrium. Okay, so going back to our picture from Chem 11, I said that if we add fluoride to barium, I get a test tube filled with precipitate of barium fluoride. Well, the picture turns out to be a bit more complex. In fact, when you add fluoride to barium, you don't immediately see a precipitate. The process of precipitate formation is very gradual, as shown in this set of pictures. First, the mixtures of the two ions are still clear. Then, as more fluoride is added, there is a slight precipitate form, which you can see here as a smoky or slight cloudiness. Last part of heavy precipitation only appears after more fluoride is added. So the important question is, what is the requirement that must be met for precipitate to form? Let's consider the equilibrium again with its KSP expression. Since this is a reversible reaction, there should be two rates. For the forward reaction, rate should equal to Kf, the rate constant in the forward direction, times the concentration of barium fluoride. This is the rate of the solid dissolving and dissociating to form aqueous ions. Notice that since the concentration of a solid is constant, the forward rate will just be a constant throughout the reaction. For the reverse reaction, rate is equal to Kr, which is the rate constant in the reverse direction, times the concentration of barium times fluoride squared. This is the rate at which solid is being formed. Unlike the forward rate, the reverse rate is always changing since the rate depends on initial concentration of these two species. If we compare these two rates, we have the following scenarios. One, we could have forward rate being greater than reverse rate. If this is the case, then we will see a clear solution because the solid is dissolving at a higher rate than it is being formed. Two, we could have forward rate equal to reverse rate. If this is the case, then we will see a slight precipitate in the solution because the solid is dissolving at the same rate that it is being formed. Three, we could have the forward rate being less than the reverse rate. If this is the case, then we will see a heavily precipitated solution because the solid is dissolving at a slower rate than it is being formed. In all three scenarios, what determines the formation of the solid is the product of the initial concentration of the two ions, barium and fluoride squared. The rate comparisons we just did can be rearranged slightly where we put the constants together on one side and the concentration terms on the other side. The result becomes the following scenarios, where in each case, the ratio of the forward and reverse rate constants is compared to the ratio of initial concentration of products over reactants. Here's where you need to remember our discussion in the equilibrium lecture, that the ratio of the forward and reverse rate constant is actually the same as K, our equilibrium constant. On the other side, the ratio of initial concentration of products to reactants is Q, the reaction quotient. So as a result, instead of comparing rate expressions, we can also compare QSP to KSP to predict precipitation. Specifically, the cases are listed below. If KSP is greater than QSP, or usually we would actually start with Q first, so QSP is less than KSP, we get a clear solution. If QSP is equal to KSP, we get a slight precipitate. If QSP is greater than KSP, we get a heavy precipitate. Let's see how we do this in practice. The KSP value of BAF2 is 1.84 times 10 to the minus 7. Can you predict what you will see in a test tube if 10 to the minus 3 barium is mixed with each of the following solution of fluoride? The way to answer this is by comparing QSP to KSP. Given the solubility equilibrium, the QSP expression is just initial concentration of barium times fluoride squared. Remember that the reactant is a solid, so it's not part of the equation. On this table, I have filled out each of the initial concentration. We can take those values and calculate QSP for each mixture. For example, for the first combination, 10 times 10 to the minus 3 times 10 to the minus 4 squared gives us 10 to the minus 11. We then compare that QSP to KSP, which is 1.84 times 10 to the minus 7. So QSP is less than KSP in this case. This leads to a prediction of a clear solution. So if you go through the table, you can see that when we add 2 times 10 to the minus 2 molar fluoride ions, we just made our QSP roughly about the same as the KSP, so we should see a small amount of precipitate forming. If we increase the fluoride after that, we get a much heavier precipitate forming. Now let's go back to our goal in this lab. Recall that the first thing we want is calculate the KSP of PbCl2, which is a slightly soluble salt. How can we accomplish this? More generally, how can you find the KSP of an insoluble salt, AB? We can actually use the procedure we just discussed with QSP and KSP, which is adding in small amounts the counter ion B- to a solution containing A+. When we add enough B- to see a slight amount of precipitate, we know that at that point, the QSP is equal to the KSP. Since we know the concentration of A+ and B- in solution, we can calculate the QSP and therefore the KSP for the salt. Here's an example. Say you want to determine the KSP of calcium hydroxide. You observe that a slight precipitate is formed when 10 milliliters of 10 to the minus 2 molar sodium hydroxide is added to 5 milliliters of 10 to the minus 2 molar calcium nitrate. How do we get the KSP? First, we must calculate the concentration of each ions in the solution. Since we're mixing two solutions, we must first use the dilution equation to calculate the new concentration of ions as shown below. below. For calcium, just take the 5 milliliter times 10 to the minus 2 divided by the total, which gives us 3.33 times 10 to the minus 3 molar. Using a similar procedure, we get for hydroxide 6.67 times 10 to the minus 3 molar. Now we calculate the KSP, which is just given by calcium concentration times hydroxide concentration squared, giving us 1.43 times 10 to the minus 7, and that would be also our KSP. All right, in the second part of the solubility equilibrium experiment, once you've made your precipitate, you have to test how volume and temperature affects the appearance of your precipitate. Given this reaction that you have, a left shift would result in more solid being formed, while a right shift results in less solid or a clearer solution. I want to end this video by briefly discussing part C of the Le Chatelier lab, which is on shifting a complex ion equilibrium. As you recall, complex ions have visible colors. So we will have a reaction that looks like this, with one complex ion on one side and the other complex ion on the other side. The colors will be blue and pink, and you will observe what happens to this equilibrium when you change volume or temperature.